Assalamualaikum, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa
after introduction like that, things can only go down. In fact, I was in Pakistan once or twice time and the chair introduced me in really glorious term, and lots of ministers and people are sitting there with anticipation. And when he finished, he says, now I invite Professor Sardar to give his address. So I got up and I said, my address is 1 Orchard Gate, London, Northwest 9, England, and sat down. It's total commotion. You know, you just can't say anything after introduction like that. But ladies and gentlemen, you may have noticed that the Oxford English Dictionary has introduced a new word in the English language, right? This is the 2016 word of the year, post-truth. Right? And the dictionary defines it as a post-truth is something that relates to circumstances in which facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion and personal beliefs. That's very interesting. Which suggests that truth is becoming less and less relevant. If you just think for a moment what Jesus said, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. So we have freely chosen not to believe in truth and therefore freely enslaved ourselves in something that we don't really know much about. So it's a very interesting position to be in. And of course, from Islamic point of view, al-haq, the truth, is a very central thing. The truth of revelation, the truth of reason, you know, both are very, very important in Islam, central to Islam. So the whole notion of creating a society which is based on post-truth is very much against the grain, if you like. It goes against history and against tradition and against what we actually believe. Not to be outdone, Merriam-Webster dictionary had its own word of the year, and he came up with surreal. They chose surreal because it was the one word that was used most often to describe what is going on in the world today, right? And it was the one word that people kind of Googled in relation to contemporary phenomena. So, for example, when President-elect Trump won the election, most people wanted to find out, you know, what did this surreal win? So the surreal became a central word for them. So both dictionaries are trying to identify something that is profoundly different from what was said 2 or 3 years ago only. And of course, there is another development at the same time. We had, in England, we had Brexit, which foxed everybody, because everybody believed that it is important for Britain to be part of Europe. You know, Europe is the future, not just of Europe, but the future of the world, in a sense, because it's Europe, European civilization, enlightenment, and all that. So the very idea that a European country will leave Europe and denounce it was very, very strange. But of course, that was followed by other things. So there's a whole kind of populism that is emerging that people find very, very difficult to comprehend. In Britain, of course, we have two varieties of populism. One is left-wing populism of Jeremy Corbyn that has kind of motivated lots of people, and other, if you may recognize, this is Boris Johnson, who is a very populist conservative MP. He was one of the leaders who led the Brexit movement. In fact, he himself was so shocked that he won that after the following morning, he just didn't know what to say. And he's an exceptionally articulate person. Great surprise. And then of course we had followed by the American populism, both Bernie Sanders and the Trump movements are very kind of populist. And people are saying, well, why all this populism? Where does all this populism comes from? Right? So what exactly is going on? What's happening to the world? And that is the question that number of people have been asking. Academics, commentators, thinkers, playwrights, scientists, number of people have been asking that. And if you look, for example, at the work of Zygmunt Bauman, for the last 10 to 15 years, he has been kind of addressing this question. He is a brilliant Polish-British sociologist who died only day before yesterday at the age of 91. And I recommend his book, Holocaust and Modernity, to all the students here. It's an essential book for you to read because he tries to prove that in that book that Holocaust could not happen without modernity. The two are deeply connected, that in a sense, in a pre-modern world, an event like Holocaust could not have taken place. It's a phenomenal book. But in a series of books in the last 10, 15 years, short books, often with a title, often with liquid in the title, he's just trying to explain what is going on. And his two books, Liquid Times and Liquid Modernity, are crucial here. And he says that everything is becoming liquid, that world is now kind of in a fluid state, things are changing, what we used to regard as solid, like enlightenment, European values, human rights, or what have you, these things are actually dissolving. You probably all know Thomas Friedman, who tried to also describe what is going on in the world, and in a book called The Earth is Flat, he came up with the word that the term global weirding, that something weird is going on in the globe, that things are weird and weird and strange. The technology journalist Robert Colville just published a book called The Great Acceleration, where he argues, in fact, that what is really happening is things are moving faster and faster, in a sense. And if you've seen the film A Money Monster, those of you who've seen it, you may remember the opening scene. The opening scene, in fact, occurs when the film hasn't actually started, and the protagonist of the film is saying if you want to make big bucks, you need to put money in big risky things. And things are moving faster and faster, and if you are in a world where things are moving faster and faster, then occasionally you will have a blown tire. An odd tire will blow. Actually, it's not just an odd tire; numerous tires are being blown up. That's basically the problem. And Calvillo basically argues that what is happening is that the change is accelerating faster and faster. Then the Indian intellectual, very well known, Pankaj Mishra, just published a book where he argues, in fact, it's the age of anger. Right? That is the title of the book, and you can actually get a summary article from the Guardian website. If you go and look at the Guardian website, you'll be able to download his long read article where he actually summarizes the arguments of the book. Then we have the very famous documentary filmmaker, Alan Curtis. Some of you may have seen it. Bitter Lake is a very famous documentary that I think most students kind of see. And his new documentary is called Hypernormalization, where he's saying that normal is becoming hyperized, and everything is hyper, whether it's thought or finances or technology, everything is becoming hyper. And geologists, you may also know, have declared that we are in a new geological age, the Anthropocene, where human beings are having a major impact on the ecology and geology of the Earth. So we have kind of shifted that from a conventional idea of Earth not being affected by human beings to a position where human beings are actually changing the ecology and geology of the Earth. And only last week, the Catholic weekly periodical, very highly respected in England, The Tablet, for which, by the way, I used to review a long time ago, came up with the age of anxiety. Several articles were saying things are very strange going on, and we are living in a very uncertain world where ignorance is increasing, and they describe it as age of anxiety. And finally, you may have seen that the famous physicist, British physicist, Stephen Hawking, many of you probably seen his film, Theory of Everything, says that we are at the most dangerous moment in the development of humanity, in a sense. So, number of people are trying to grasp what the hell is going on, what is happening. And all of these contentions are partially true. Yes, we are in an age of anger, we probably are in the most dangerous moment. Yes, there's a great acceleration. But if you just step back and try and synthesize what all these people are saying, then you will come to the conclusion that what they're actually saying is that we have lost trust in what we thought was conventional and normal. We have lost trust in the political process. We have lost trust in the market. We have lost trust in the economy, economics as a disciplinary field. We don't trust politicians. We don't even trust doctors in some cases. You know, we don't trust experts. In Britain, there's a huge kind of movement started by another Brexiteer, Michael Gove, who said that experts, well, what do they know? Right, so there's a kind of anti-expert movement that the experts cannot be trusted. Now, this is specifically to do with the fact that experts predicted numerous elections which were systematically wrong. They predicted, for example, Brexit will not happen. It happened. They predicted, well, it's going to be a close election, but actually Hillary Clinton will win. Well, she didn't win. They predicted that the Italian Prime Minister will win his referendum. It will be all right. Well, he didn't win his referendum, right? And Italy is not all right. It's in a total mess. So experts are being looked into the suspicious as well. So we don't seem to trust anything that is normal anymore, right, in a sense. And the term that we use to describe, which includes all these things. That we are in a society of accelerating change. There's a great deal of anxiety and anger out there. That we are in a dangerous moment in history. The term that we use that is post-normal time. This is the term that we research, and it is a term that we come up with. It's a term that has a little history. The reason we are using it, it's a history. It has about 25 years history, not as post-normal times, but as post-normal science. Because one of the first indications that things are not quite right emerge in science before they actually emerge in society as such. So the post-normal science movement has a long history, and we built on this. And we, in the post-normal times kind of theory, and the work we are doing is very much part of the IIIT thing, in a sense. I mean, IIIT has been kind of helping us to actually develop the theory and take it further. Now, it is important to realize that we are not in end. This is not about end times. This is not a theological absolutist end time. It's about the fact that at this moment in history, the planet Earth, the American society, the British society, and Muslim world are in a very peculiar moment. A moment where what they believe to be conventional, traditional, normal, does not hold anymore. It's being either questioned or it's dissolving. It's not as solid as it used to be. So it's not an end point, it's a transition point, right? And that's the kind of definition that I came up with in a paper that I published in 2010. And that's the definition that's basically been accepted, that it's an in-between period where old orthodoxies are dying, new ones have yet not emerged, and nothing really seems to make sense. This is one particular formulation of post-normal times. Other people have come up with similar formulations, although they are not related. They don't describe it as post-normal times. So you have the Italian journalist Moro, who's in a book called Babel, written with Zygmunt Bauman together, came out about 2 or 3 years ago. He said that we are hanging between the no longer and the not yet. And thus we are necessarily unstable, in a sense. So saying more or less the same thing, but in a kind of more general term, not within a theoretical framework. Now, why? What is so special about this post-normal period? Well, one of the first thing is that we live in a globalized world. But everybody realized that we live in a globalized world. It's not very bright, this one.
It's too light in the room.
Oh, too much light in the room? Okay.
All the light, but that's
not going to work. And I can't see the audience. Okay, never mind. We all know that we live in a globalized world. But not many of us appreciate what it actually means to be in a globalized. What does globalization actually mean? What does it mean to be living in a globalized world? Now, the best way I can explain that is in terms of three S's, right? In the post-normal time theory, we always tend to do three things in three and in kind of, you know, to make things more interesting. So the first thing I think one need to realize, are you going to move forward or?
Oh, I was waiting for your signal.
Yeah. Oh, okay. All right. The first thing you need to realize is that the things happen with tremendous kind of, the scale is different, right? Things become globalized very, very quickly. So here we have Pastor John. Now, you may have heard of Pastor John. Pastor John was pastor of a church. I can't even remember the name of the church, some obscure church in Gainesville, Florida. His congregation was, I think, number 29. Various figures exist, but from 29 to 35, that was the entire congregation. And one day he decided to burn the Quran, right? He didn't actually burn the Quran, he simply decided that he's going to burn the Quran, and he made an announcement that he's going to burn the Quran. Now, this happening in Gainesville, Florida, it has no relevance to anything in the world, right? Nothing at all, a totally insignificant pastor, insignificant kind of community announcing that he's going to burn the Quran. Of course, this is reported in a local paper, it's then picked up very quickly in the national press. Before you know it, CNN, BBC, you know, RT, Al Jazeera are perpetually kind of broadcasting the fact that he's going to burn the Quran, right? He comes on television to say, I'm going to burn the Quran. They arrive in Karachi, people die in Karachi. They arrive in Indonesia. The American embassy in Cairo is attacked. And the Saudis are threatening to do all sorts of things, as they normally do. Although they never do anything, but they do threaten. And Hillary Clinton, then Secretary of State, had to get on the phone and plead with him not to burn the Quran. This is an example of how, in a globalized world, small things can acquire global scale very, very quickly. Right? And the way the things kind of move can be really appreciated by looking at Malala. Malala, as you know, is a young Pakistani girl who was shot by the Taliban. And then she was brought to England, where she recovered, she became a kind of global icon. And within a period of 18 months, this girl who was going to a school, a village school in Pakistan, won the Nobel Prize, published an autobiography, addressed the United Nations gathering, and became a UNESCO ambassador within the period of 18 months. So you can see how quickly things can emerge and change from total obscurity, right? And now, of course, she's the ambassador for all girls who aspire to be educated, whether they're in Africa or in, so things can move very fast and very quickly. It is important to realize this is what globalization means, scale and speed. There's a third thing about globalization that most people don't appreciate, is that spontaneity. Things happen spontaneously, right? It is when things happen spontaneously that real kind of mega events take place. Now this is about speeds, just to give you an example of Zika. Now, people think Zika was only emerged 2 or 3 years ago. Actually, Zika virus has existed since 1949, right? But nothing very much happened because people didn't travel that much, right? There was no globalization. And if this is only from your current current article in Scientific American, the current issue of Scientific American. So if you look at here, it's only in 2015 that Zika virus suddenly spread very widely. Why? Because that's where people were really traveling left, right, and center, and you know, a lot of movement, and almost the planet Earth is like a village, people going from Brazil, you know, to England, coming to Miami, and so forth. So things, the speed is very important to appreciate. And then the other thing is, of course, as I said earlier on, simultaneity. Things do emerge simultaneously. And this was first observed by Ban Ki-moon, the outgoing General Secretary of the United States. In a famous speech in 2009 in Dublin, Ban Ki-moon said this. I'm not going to read it out, but you can see what he's saying. He's saying that since suddenly we find in ourselves, the United Nations finds itself where they have to deal with things simultaneously, or everything seems to be happening simultaneous in a sense. Now all this is essentially what globalization is about. To really appreciate the importance of globalization, we need to look at speed, scale, and simultaneously. But at the same time, we also know that the world is. Why have you moved proxy one?
Oh, sorry.
Yes. Oh, okay. We can move proxy one. There's an example of things happening simultaneously, right? So, just how many different wars are being fought at this moment in time, simultaneously? Like, there's war on terror, right? Suddenly we find ourselves in Cold War between Russia and the West. There are lots of proxy wars. Proxy wars, for example, Saudi Arabia and Iran fighting their war in Syria and Iraq, right? And other proxy wars of Western powers being conducted. Move on to next one? Yeah. There's cyber wars, we all know about that. In the last election, there is now evidence to suggest that Russia actually interfered with the American elections. But we know that Russia has interfered, in fact, with lots of different elections. Indeed, 26 different countries in Latin America and Africa have been interfered with in terms of election through cyber wars. If you look at the data, it's not just the United States. But hackers have interfered in elections in Latin American countries and in African countries. There's Twitter wars, as we now know. Twitter wars are very, very important. Let me give you an example that Twitter wars can be very, very serious. 3 or 4 weeks ago, somebody tweeted, in the name of the Israeli defense minister, that if Pakistan interfered in Syria, Israel will nuke it. Immediately, the Pakistani defense minister tweeted, "We too are a nuclear power. We will nuke you too." Right. And that everybody realized that this is going to escalate very rapidly, and there must be some pressure must be put on Israel or something. And the Israeli defense minister came out and said, "No, this is all news. It's all fabricated, the courts are made up, nothing like that happened. We have no intention of anything like that." And so Twitter can lead to major events. And we know that the president-elect likes to do things on Twitter, right? So the potential for dangerous escalation is very high. And there are, of course, various varieties of hybrid warfare that is going on. This is very big in Britain. The whole hybrid warfare, in the sense that Britain now feels that it's been threatened in a number of different ways, especially post-Brexit, by all sorts of different means. So all these wars are taking place simultaneously. Conventionally, of course, we had a war, you know, military engagement, but now we have all sorts of different varieties of war that we had not thought of before. So globalization, scale, speed, simultaneity, but at the same time we also network. I mean, the whole world is connected in one network after another network. I mean, network is the thing at this moment. Everything is network. One way or other, everything is network. And at the same time, go ahead, carry on. Yeah. And this is in fact what we mean by post-normal change. The scale, simultaneity, speed, and the fact that things are very networked. When things are very networked, they tend to move very, very fast. Right? Especially if you have complexity. And things are very complex in contemporary times. So, I mean, almost everything you can think of is complex. There is a paper just published about a month ago which argues that governance in America is so complex that no president can solve it, that a presidential democracy is not workable in the governing system that we have in America. Right? It requires a different kind of political system, the complexity. Jody there wrote a paper on governance in the European Union. You've got 27 different states fighting each other, pulling in a different direction. Right? How do you govern an institution that is like that, that has its own bureaucracy in Brussels? It's impossible for the European Union to be governed in any sensible way. So complexity is very, very important. Now, just to give you an example of how complex human relationships have become. In 2006 or 7, I became the Commissioner for Equality and Human Rights Commission in Britain. It was the first time the commission was set up, and I was one of the first commissioner announced as a commissioner, and part of my job was to look at religion and diversity in religious terms and see how we can bring equality. And one of the initial functions of the commission was to establish equality law, which we did. So 2010, we had the equality legislation 2010, which is the law now. So when I started, they said, you have to deal with LGBT, right? So lesbian, gays, bisexual, and trans. I said, well, yeah, that's all right. I think I can deal with that. So when we started thinking about it, what are we going to do in terms of equality? We had various representations from various groups, and they said, no, that is old. You have to deal with this. Lesbians, gay, bisexual, trans, queer, intersex, asexual, and gender non-conforming. So I said, I don't even know what half of these terms mean, but I'll have to deal with any of them, right? And of course, you know, to have any kind of equality legislation that is based on this notion of kind of complex sexual orientation is just mind-bogglingly complex. I mean, it's a wicked problem. That means it cannot really be solved in any way. But now things have moved on even further. So now we have this, right? And the new folks have to deal with this: the lesbian, gay, bisexual, trans, queer, intersex, asexual, gender non-conforming, questioning, pansexual, ally or allied, I don't know to what, straight, leather, fetish, polyamorous, monogamous, polyandrous, and bigamist, right? Now, that is mind-bogglingly ridiculous and complicated. But you cannot say that any of, go back, you cannot say that any of these people do not actually feel this identity. You cannot question their identity. You cannot undermine their identity. They have right to describe themselves the way they want to describe, just as Muslims have the right to describe themselves as they want to describe. So you have to take them seriously. So then the question is, how do you deal with it? Just in case you think that, you know, this is all not really very real, this is the Durham Students Union LGBT plus A website. This is, if you go to Durham University, which is a very, very good very old established university in England, very strong Islamic studies department, very well known. This is what they describe them, their group as.
There's even more.
And the student at our universities have to accept all that and deal with it. Right? And they, this was this the reason I kind of saw this, because there was a slight controversy, the university saying, how are we going to deal with all this mind-boggling sexual orientation, and there was a little issue. So I actually went and looked at the website, and you can all do that as well, and you will discover that this is what they are all kind of. So complexity is very, very important in the world that we have created. And allied to this, we also have serious contradictions. I mean, if you have a kind of, say, even if you go back to the lesbian and gay, I mean, the terms are quite self-contradictory in some cases. They're so complex. And obviously the most glaring contradiction is the inequality you can see side by side, a luxury hotel and a slum right next to it. And this you find in most cities. This is a very unique, universal, one of the most glaring contradictions. But the real ironic contradictions of the globalized world were actually described so beautifully by an online advertisement, right? An online advertisement that's actually inviting you to do something by pointing out how ridiculous the world has become. It says Uber, the world's largest taxi company, owns no vehicles. Facebook, the world's most popular media owner, creates no content. Alibaba, the most valuable retailer, has no inventory. And Airbnb, the world's largest accommodation provider, owns no real estate. Something interesting is happening indeed, right? So you can see the glaring contradiction that is so obvious that people are now actually using these contradictions as a form of advertisement, right? And this advertisement was put on Facebook, and it emerged, it appeared all over the place. It suddenly appeared in my wife's Facebook page, and I said, what? Show me. So you can see. So contradictions and complexity, right? In a network situation, if you have a complexity and contradictions in a network situation, what are you going to get? You're going to get positive feedback, right? And in positive feedbacks, things multiply dramatically, and then and chaos is created. And chaos need not be a major evil; it could be a profound evil in that sense. So if we step back at the two things that I pointed out earlier on, the post-truth society and populism, is it really surprising that popular movements are emerging? Well, let's look at what's been happening. Yeah, one of the biggest contradictions we face is inequality, right? What does inequality do? It makes people angry. It frustrates them. And they get humiliated when inequality is justified by naked capitalism. By saying, actually, austerity is necessary because that is how we're going to get out of the economic problem that we have. Or by saying, well, actually, the bankers deserve their bonuses, right? Even though they are absolutely ridiculous, like, you know, millions and millions of dollars, even when they fail. If you look at political systems, as I was saying, you know, the political systems cannot deliver anything that all these angry people, all these people who are suffering from want. I mean, in terms of inequality, one of the most striking statistics is that when we first started working on post-normal times in 2010, there were 86 people who owned 80% of the world's wealth, right? And we prepared a nice little PowerPoint. When we came to make a presentation next, the following year, the number has changed to 76. and the number has been going down every year. So every year we have, well, I don't know what the latest number is.
I think 60.
And 60. So every year the number goes down, and you can actually say that less and less people are own more and more. In today's free newspaper that was in my hotel, I don't know, US Today, I think it's called, the lead story is that half a dozen people have made $18 trillion after the election of Obama. It's in today's newspaper, right? $18 trillion. That means if half a dozen people have made $18 trillion, that also means that vast number of Americans have been deprived of something, in a sense. So inequality is deep. Political system cannot deal with that. Specifically, they cannot deal with minority. Whether the minorities are, Kurds in Turkey, or the Shias in Iraq, or if you look at any democratic political system, they just cannot deal with minorities in adequate way. But of course, in Europe, we have a new minority. A minority that is conventionally not used to being deprived, the minority of whites, right? And they therefore feel very, very angry, right? They've never actually, they've always had an upper hand, and suddenly they don't have an upper hand, right? There's a major grievance. And if you look at all these people with grievances, on the social media, what are they doing? What does social media do? Social media has a basic contradiction. It connects and it disconnects. It connects you with all those people who share your views, but disconnects you from all those people who oppose your views. So you are in a bubble. You're constantly in a bubble and you are reinforcing your views. So if you have an extremist view, you are in connection with all the other networks of extremists, and you're constantly kind of in reinforcing your view. If you're a leftist and you're connected with left, sorry, what were you saying?
No.
If you're a leftist, you're connecting the leftist group, and therefore you're so there's no real interaction with the people. Engagement with people with genuine differences of opinion. There's no debate and discussion as such. So in a situation like that, it is not surprising that populism has emerged. And people, particularly in Britain, said, all these people who are populist and supporting Brexit or voting for Obama are irrational, people. Okay, if they are irrational, well, the bloody economy has been behaving irrationally for the last 10 years. What about that? It's hardly unusual, right? And politicians have been behaving irrationally. And if you look at the whole question of post-truth, there are two or three trends which actually told us that we are going to be emerging. We'll come to that, I mean. If you look at post-truth, for the last 30 years, the academics in Europe, Britain, Australia, and in some part of the Muslim world, has been teaching their students that truth is not important. This philosophy is called postmodernism. The first basic pillar of postmodernism is that grand narratives are meaningless. In other words, anything that has a truth claim has no meaning, right? That truth is relative. Two generations of young people have grown up who believe that truth is relative, there's no absolute truth of any kind, right? And that my opinion is as good as somebody else's opinion, which is based on evidence. That my version of the truth is as valid as your version of the truth, even though your version of the truth may be based on hard science, right? And evidence. For the last 20 years, politicians throughout the world, not just in America or Britain or Europe, throughout the world, have been economical with the truth. This is the technical term. They have been economical with the truth. Why? Because the things are so complex they cannot explain them. When the policymaker come and say to them, this is what it is all about, this connection, that connection, this is a network, this is complex, And they say, well, how am I going to explain that to people? Simplify. But the very process of simplification is economical with the truth, right? So politicians lie. They lie out of necessity, in a sense. And even the most politicians with the most integrity, the most wonderful human being who's really concerned about, is forced to be economical with the truth because he or she cannot explain the complexity of the world. And then, of course, we've had whole genre of new media, new television programs, of which reality TV is one, which actually promotes ruthlessness, right? In Britain, we have, three or four reality TV programs, very, very popular. They promote aggressive individualism, ruthlessness, and greed. And in these programs, you win by being completely ruthless. You have to destroy your opponent, you have to humiliate other people, only then you get to win, right? And then, of course, we have Twitter, we have Facebook, etc. So, why should we be surprised that we are in a post-truth society? The trends have been taking us there. What's actually happened is that all these events and trends have come together simultaneously and created a post-truth moment in that sense. So, in many respects, it is not surprising what is going on. Even though some people may be surprised by it. So let me just put three or four things on the table for you, what it means for Muslim community as a whole. Right. And these are not predictions. I'm not making predictions. I'm not even making forecasts. I'm just suggesting these things are possible and plausible and therefore ought to be anticipated, right? And we ought to be prepared for them to some extent. So number one is the emergence of far right in Europe. This is the first four openly far right fascist members of the European Parliament. Some people can recognize Marie Le Pen, Greet from Holland. I don't even know who the other two
Now,
what does Europe believe normally? The fundamental belief in Europe and the European Union is that Europe can never go back to fascism. That's taken for granted. That is the normal thing, right? The post-normal is that far-right has emerged in a big way. One-third of France actually votes for a far-right candidate, and it's not unlikely that Marine Le Pen will become a president of France, if not next time, maybe next time, one after that. In Austria, the far-right candidate lost by 2,000 votes. Card-carrying fascist lost by 2,000 votes. And there was, if you remember, there was a recount. There was a second time. So it came very, very close. In Hungary, in Slovakia, in Poland, far-right governments are in power. Actually, the far-right government is in power in the biggest democracy in the world, India. The BJP is a far-right government. Right. So the emergence of the right is very serious consequence for Muslim society. About 10 years ago, when I was a columnist on the New Statesman, my job was to write two columns a month and an essay. And for one of the essays, the editor had a very kind of bright idea. He said, we're going to drop you in the middle of Europe, and you have to go out and engage with ordinary people and travel with a photographer. So one particular night, they dropped me in the middle of Germany with a photographer. We didn't even know where we were. And they simply said, now start traveling, you know, take this train and go there and just engage with ordinary people. And so I went from Germany to Belgium to Holland. Finally, we ended up in France in Lille, came back to London, and then I wrote the piece. Just engaging with ordinary people. And the only thing that I was told is when you engage with ordinary people, you should tell them you are a Muslim. Right? And so when the story came out, the cover line they put in, it's not my cover line, the next Holocaust. Right? You can go to New State, if you Google New Statesman, next Holocaust, you will find the article, right, in a sense. So it is a very serious, the Muslims need to take this very, very seriously. It is not something, you know, that one can underplay, and it's established trend in that sense. Then second, of course, this is, would you believe, a single shot of fake news in a single day. On YouTube, Amazon, Google, all the kind of, this is a paper that just came out 2 or 3 weeks ago, where this guy actually said, let's look at this fake news, where is it coming from? Is it just 2 or 3 websites? Or is it a big phenomenon? And he was shocked at the extent of that. Now, a great deal of this fake news is actually directed towards Muslims. Go out there and look at how many Islamophobe websites are there that are describing Muslims as evil and barbarian. Right? It is not kind of incidental that Trump will use, you know, the Muslims as one way of getting his message across, that we should, you know, we should can have a Muslim register. But this is not just Trump. This is happening in Europe, France, Hungary. It's happening in India now. We don't seem to realize how much fake news, anti-Islamophobic fake news comes out of India. So fake news is very, very important. And notice, if you recall earlier on, I talked about one fake tweet that nearly resulted in a nuclear war, right? So these things have to be taken seriously. They're not, you know, they cannot be ignored in a sense. Then let me just give you two other things before I conclude. One is weaponization of code, the intelligence code. This is a weaponized little machine gun. You can program it simply to pick up Muslims by racial profiling, right? Now you may think that, oh, this is a bit wild. Well, only 6 months ago, Microsoft released an AI. I think the name was what, Tai or something. Remember what was the Tay. And that was a kind of AI bot. And it was kind of basically designed to, you interact with it and you can find things out and do something. Within 24 hours, this Thai artificial intelligence bot became fascist, right? He started abusing anti-Islamophobic stuff, high Hitler and all that. Why did that happen? Because the people who were interacting with it fed him those lines, and Microsoft had to remove it. Right? Apologized to people. So code can be recognized in a number of different ways. And if you have a kind of an administration that actually looks at Muslims with suspicion, then the probability and the possibility that it may actually turn a blind eye to those who want to turn artificial intelligence or other form of computer code into weapons, you know, possibility is there. Then the final one is, I would say, the weaponization of DNA. Now again, you may think that this is not possible, but in the post-normal times, anything that is technically feasible will happen. Doesn't matter if it has ethical consequences or not, doesn't matter if it's bad. If it's feasible, then somebody will turn into a reality because somebody can make money out of it. Right? If something is feasible, it will happen. Right? And when we actually talk of, say, for example, things like eugenics, what do we think of? We think of the Nazis. We don't think of Harvard, do we? The biggest eugenics program in the world was not in Nazi Germany, it was at Harvard. And at that period, the president of Harvard was a right-wing, card-carrying right-wing fascist. Right? And the program, there's a couple of books there. I think one was called The Jansons or something like that, that actually tell you the whole story of how Harvard played a major part in the eugenics program in America. So this is not a fantasy. It could actually happen. So finally, just in the, if you want to kind of, you have about 10 minutes or two?
No, we don't.
You don't.
Two minutes.
No. Okay. So finally, let me just conclude by saying that, but basically reiterating the point that I'm not making. These are not predictions. We are not into predictions, and these are not forecasts. This is just an analysis of what is possible and what is plausible. Purely what is possible and what is plausible. And as long as it is plausible and possible, it will be foolish for us to be complacent, right? And from that point of view, I think that future of Muslim communities in America and Europe will very much depend on how these communities anticipate these and other similar developments. Right. Now they need not happen. One post-normal time is not just a description of what is going on, it's also a challenge of creating a new paradigm, of moving forward to a new order, to a new world, right, which is totally different from the world that we have inherited at this moment in time. If it's a period of transition, if it's an in-between period, then we ought to have a vision of where we can go, which is a better place, where some of these things can be sidestepped. So it's both a description of how the world is and an invitation and a challenge to make the world a better place. Thank you very much.